3, 2, 1.
There are several estate planning mistakes folks are making. Here to tell us a few of them is lawyer Avi Kestenbaum. So, Avi, first, you said, you know, the failure to plan is a big one.
Yes, I think the greatest mistake that people make when it comes to their estate plans is not doing any planning, or perhaps starting the planning process and then stopping in the middle. Why this happens, there could be a number of factors, fear of death, fear of discussing death, concerns that no matter what planning is done, there'll be disputes and there are no easy answers. Perhaps the advisor doesn't have the right bedside manners and doesn't make his or her client feel comfortable. But that certainly is the biggest mistake, which is not doing anything, because obviously a plan will not work if nothing is done.
Yeah, I've heard people say, you know, I'm afraid to plan because if I plan, that will hasten my death. I mean, what do you say to that?
So it's actually interesting. I give them a little tidbit, and that is as follows, which may sound a little bit strange, but I tell them that sort of the angel of death hovers over, and if somebody hasn't planned and there's room to create mischief, well, that angel of death will take advantage and say, hey, I can really mess with this family because they haven't done any planning. I'm going to knock this guy off and there'll be a disaster. But if somebody actually does his or her planning, well, the angel of death doesn't care if that person lives because everything will be fine after they've executed their planning. Executed may be a bad choice of words, but the point is that does make them feel a little bit more comfortable to tell them, hey, this is a positive thing. You're putting things in order.
That's a good one. Good one. So tell us, you said not understanding the difference between what goes into probate and what's outside of probate.
Yes, a lot of people are not familiar that the documents they have don't work. For example, there's a distinction under the law between probate and non-probate assets. A probate asset is an asset that passes under the will. A non-probate asset is an asset that passes by operation of law. Many assets that people have don't even pass under the will. So for example, a joint account with the rights of survivorship, owning a property with somebody else with rights of survivorship, a beneficiary designation under a life insurance policy, a beneficiary designation with an IRA, those assets will not pass under the will. The will is irrelevant. It matters what it says under those designations. And a lot of people haven't checked their designations in a while, haven't updated them, and there could be a disaster waiting to happen that the assets end up in the hands of the wrong person.
Another reason to keep your eye on those designations. Now, another thing you said is keep an eye on estate taxes and gift taxes. Tell us about that.
Sure. Many of us are familiar that there is a federal gift tax and there's also a federal estate tax. What a lot of people perhaps don't think about is if there were gifts made during lifetime and perhaps the IRS didn't catch those gifts, but later on after death, the IRS asserts a gift tax for previous gifts, well, who pays that gift tax liability? And all estate planning documents, or certainly wills, should have what are referred to as tax apportionment clauses, meaning who bears the burden of those estate taxes or prior gifts. And a lot of people would be surprised to know that if there is an estate tax due, perhaps a different party than they expect actually has to bear the burden of paying the estate tax. So, for example, with the lifetime transfers, perhaps those people will get those assets free of all taxes, and the people who receive those assets upon death, those people will actually have to pay the taxes for the prior transfers, and they end up with nothing.
So another mistake you said is folks leaving assets outright.
Yes. I'm a big believer, as are many estate planners, that there's very little reason to leave assets outright, even to adult and responsible beneficiaries. Obviously, to a child or to a person who may perhaps be having issues, it would be smart to leave the assets in trust. But even if an individual had a very, very bright, well-accomplished, responsible child, why not still leave those assets in trust for that child? Because the child could even be trustee over his or her own trust. And the concept is the child has access to them, but nobody else does. So it's sort of the best of both worlds. Outside of the child's estate as well, outside the child's future estate, protected from divorce, protected from creditors, the assets will eventually pass to the next generation, the grandchildren or the child's children. And the only catch is that if the child wants a distribution, he or she may have to appoint a co-trustee of his or her choosing. But again, the best of both worlds, control, but no one else can reach those assets.
Great tips. Thank you so much, Avi.
Thank you.